winners. Welcome to the Odds Breakers, your number one place for shared, sharp betting information.
Merry Christmas and happy holidays, my friends, and welcome back to podcast 79 of 2020. I'm your host, Kiev O'Neill. You can follow me on Twitter at OBKiev. Follow us at The Odds Breakers. Follow us on social media / The Odds Breakers. This episode is being brought to you by MyBookie.ag. For a 200% sign-up bonus, please visit MyBookie and use the promo code The Odds Breakers. Terms, conditions, and location apply. If you'd like to help us out with our costs and sponsor the website and the podcast, we would love to help you out. Please visit theoddsbreakers.com, click shop, and become a member. For $24.99 a month, you can get my plays and premium plays before the line moves. If nothing else, please visit theoddsbreakers.com and become a free picks newsletter subscriber. We have a fantastic show for you today. Marco D'Angelo from Wagertalk.com is back to help us find some huge value and lighten up your Christmas spirits. Marco is going to cover some NFL games with us. I'm so excited and thankful he's coming on to do that. I'm going to cover some college football before Marco comes on. And these bowls are obviously huge. We have some value that I'm going to discuss. I'm going to talk a little bit about bowls' home field potential advantages here. I'm going to talk about some motivational spots for these bowl teams. And I'm going to get into our college bowls left off from December 23rd from the last pod to December 24th through December 26th. I'm going to give you some bowl plays and some bowl leans. After that, Marco's going to come on, do the NFL with us, and we're going to close out with our teaser and the sharp side of the force to bring in your holiday cheer. Before we get to that, we have a question from Alan Stoy at Alan Stoye on Twitter. Wanted to know a little bit about the fact that I had a play in college football at -2.5, but it was only a lean at -3. So obviously the line went down into my favor from my number. 3 is the most common number in football. As a matter of fact, it lands on a 3 16% of the time. And it lands on your 3 60% of that, because the percentage of 3 of a -3 is 60% winning percentage. So it's about a 9% point advantage. As we know, you have to be 52.38% right on all of your bets throughout the year to make a profit. Anything after that, you can make a profit at -110 juice. Well, the percentage from going from 3 all the way to, for example, 2.5 is about a 5% move. So it is definitely a play. And especially when you have a lean at -3 and it gets down to -2.5, it for sure makes it a play. Because your number, if you have a lean at -3, is somewhere between -3 and -3.5, right? So at -3.5, if that's your number, you should be playing your -3s mathematically. We have an article on our site that you should all read called Intro to Sports Betting 101. If you go to theoddsbreakers.com, you'll click on Bets, Info, and Trends. You'll see the article Introduction to Sports Betting 101. It explains that. It explains why you only have to be at 52.38% of your bets. Right? Some people would say, well, no, Vegas takes $9 every $100 I bet. It doesn't work like that. Vegas puts up money too, and the law of diminishing returns comes down to 52.38% of your bets. The more bets you make, the less the -110 factors in. For example, if you bet $1,000 all in $1 bets, right? And you hit 53% of them, you win $530 with zero VIG, minus 100, whatever, plus 100, zero VIG, and you lose $470. At VIG minus 110, you have to take $530 times 0.91, which is roughly $480. So in that scenario, you lost 470, you made 480, means you made 10 bucks, and the books made 50 bucks at minus 110 VIG. Okay? That's how that works. And when you look at the chart, 3 is the most common number in football. So the percentage difference between 2.5 and 3 is about a 5 percentage point difference, which is past 2.38. While if you look at 8 to 8.5, it is less than a 1 percentage point difference. So that's why key numbers are extremely important. You asked about buying off key numbers for 25 cents. It's to go from 3 to 3.5. It's or 3 to 2.5. It's 25 cents extra, right? So, I mean, roughly, you're laying minus 110. It's like laying minus 135, right? Buying off those numbers. To be honest with you, that's pretty close to right. Buying off numbers, it's not like a huge ripoff or anything, but you think you're getting a better chance by getting off that number. But it, as far as the percentage points, it's pretty close to even. People fight about this back and forth, how important it is to buy off numbers. I just tell them it's personal preference. You know, it's personal preference to do that. To be honest with you, the way I look at it is kind of like how Felica looks at it. If a spread's not getting you to 3 and it's at 2.5, you can't get the plus 3, it's at plus 2.5, you're probably right on the plus 2.5 side anyway. You know, that's kind of the way I look at it. Some other people say, I'm going to pay the 25 cents to get the 3. So if you haven't read that article, it's got all that information. Intro to Sports Betting 101 on our website, theoddsbreakers.com. Make sure you check that out. Great question, Alan. Thank you for asking that. For our next segment, I'm going to discuss college football 2020 bowls teams closer to home. That gives them a slight home field advantage via travel, via recency if they played in that stadium before. Maybe they had their state championship, you know, there. Maybe they have limited fans and you can get some fans there. Not too big of a travel for you. You know, I wanted to cover this because there is going to be some slight home field advantage, maybe a point or so, right? On the other hand, a team could be sad that they're only going 100, 200, 300 miles away to play, but at the same time, they can look at it just as a business trip. Hard to gauge that part of the motivation. But what's important is if they can have some fans and the fact that they aren't going too far, I thought this was very important to cover. It's important every year. We're always going to cover home field advantage in these bowls. So here are those teams. The Boca Raton Bowl, UCF versus BYU. And this is only a 200-mile drive for UCF. And I'm not sure, I mean, you're probably not going to get the podcast by the time you get it. But I just wanted to mention that BYU has to travel across the country. Florida has been having some fans. So I do expect some Central Florida fans down there. I would give them a point for home field advantage. The New Orleans Bowl. And you have Louisiana Tech versus Georgia Southern. Just a half-day, 300-mile drive for Louisiana Tech down to New Orleans. I'm sure these kids have been to New Orleans many times from Louisiana. And Georgia is obviously quite a bit farther away for Georgia Southern. You know, 1,000 miles or so. Not exactly sure the number. But either way, more of a home field advantage for Louisiana Tech. The Alamo Bowl, Texas versus Colorado. Only an 80-mile drive for Texas from Austin to San Antonio. All right, 80 miles. A little bit of a home field advantage for Texas. The Duke's Mayo Bowl, Wake Forest versus Wisconsin. Only an hour drive from Wake Forest to Charlotte, North Carolina. 1 hour. 70 miles. So a bit of a home game for Wake Forest, but Badgers, if they can have fans there, Badgers will show up. Just want to let you know that. Also wanted to say the Badgers, hard to test their motivation on this one. Armed Forces Bowl, Mississippi State versus Tulsa. This is a 300-mile trip for Tulsa to Fort Worth, Texas. Okay, so obviously Tulsa, Oklahoma, right next to Texas, Mississippi State a little farther away. Finally, we have the Texas Bowl, TCU versus Arkansas, only a 263-mile trip from Dallas to Houston. So TCU, definitely more of a home field advantage for this bowl themselves. For this next segment, we're going to have college football bowl game motivational spots. Very, very important. And I also want to mention that if you're going to make an early play, which I do, be careful for some of the bigger teams. Or be careful if you know that there's an NFL star on these other teams, especially in this COVID year. A potential NFL star may be sitting out this game. I'm more inclined to bet the other team if I like them early, because you can expect possibly somebody from Georgia to sit out. That's key, like a linebacker or possibly a wide receiver or something like that. So be very careful when betting the bigger teams early. Florida already lost their tight end there to the NFL. So I'm going to start out with highly questionable motivation. I'm going to go down to questionable motivation. Then I'm going to go to normal expected motivation, and then potentially high motivation to win the games, right? So obviously, the reason I say questionable is because you can't tell for sure what they're going to think. But just out of past experience, similar to when Miami played Louisiana Tech last year and just lost and did not care, they had pretty much knew everything at that university. That's when you know you can count on it. That's important. You want to count on your thoughts. And this is part of handicapping games. We're going to start right away with the Union Home Mortgage Gasparilla Bowl, South Carolina versus UAB. South Carolina was 2-8 this year, and they fired their coach. Okay, this is kind of like the LA Tech versus Miami game last year, except Miami was actually favored somehow in that game. But I would never come close to betting South Carolina here in a highly questionable spot. The Goodyear Cotton Bowl, Oklahoma versus Florida. Florida was shooting for the playoffs, and they almost had it with that last drive versus Bama. What is their feelings going to be here to play Oklahoma? Now, it's a good bowl, Cotton Bowl, obviously. And Trask is trying to make the NFL, so there's two key points of motivation. But at the same time, their spirits have to be a little bit crushed. It would be hard. I'd be hard-pressed to bet Florida here. I think the line might have factored it in too, because I do have Florida a much bigger favorite than the line at -2.5, -3. I think I have Florida around a -5 or -6. So remember, the line might already factor some of this stuff in. Capital One Orange Bowl, highly questionable spot. Texas A&M versus North Carolina. Just the sheer amount of whining that came out of Texas A&M in their mouths about missing the playoffs because of Ohio State making it, tells me they might not be that motivated here, right? I mean, thinking that they're going to be in playoffs, they feel slighted, even though it's the freaking Orange Bowl, which should be huge. Now, on the other side of the coin, they might be overconfident here and think they're way better than North Carolina and could be a pushover. So this is a very interesting handicap. You know, if anything, Texas A&M should be mad at the process, the extremely flawed and biased system of four teams. That's what they should be mad at. You know, don't be mad at Ohio State. Be mad at the idiots that made this stupid system. All right. I mean, I deal with it every year. It's wrong no matter what you do. So, unfortunately, they like their money, and they keep things where they want it, so the top four teams make it. Questionable motivation. And this is legit. It's now I wouldn't. I'd factor this in a little bit to your handicap, not as much as highly questionable, but the Surf Pro First Responder Bowl, Louisiana versus UTSA. Louisiana co-won their conference with Coastal Carolina because that game was canceled. And that just might be enough for them. You know, I don't know. It's a big spread. I'd be hard to bet Louisiana here against UTSA that's probably going to show up for this game. Okay. Duke's Mayo Bowl, Wake Forest versus Wisconsin. Wisconsin was shooting for much bigger things this year, especially after that Michigan game, and then their spirits were crushed in Northwestern. But at the same time, a few years back in 2018, they crushed Miami in the same situation. So just a little bit of a slight to Wisconsin, and Wake Forest has that home field. And that's why I saw Wake Forest money come in. The home, the closer to the home, and the fact that Wisconsin is in a weird, kind of like in a bad bowl spot. AutoZone Liberty Bowl, San Jose State versus Ball State. Both of these teams have questionable motivation because they both won their conference, but it's hard to predict if either one of them or both of them is going to be motivated. Maybe they both are. Maybe it's just Ball State. Maybe it's just San Jose State. It's just kind of questionable, so it makes me want to stay away from this bowl itself. You know, at least aside, possibly look at the total. The Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl, Cincinnati versus Georgia. Cincinnati will be very motivated, but Georgia's expectations are always
playoffs. Don't talk about playoffs. You kidding me? Playoffs?
So, this reminds me of when Auburn played UCF 3-4 years ago and lost outright. All right? Kind of reminds me of that. Although Auburn was a lot closer to making the playoffs than Georgia was this year. So just remember that. Cure Bowl, Coastal Carolina versus Liberty, plus 6.5. The total on this is 59. Coastal Carolina really got screwed here, not being in a New Year's Six. But at the same time, this bowl was supposed to be played. You know, or this game was supposed to be played and it was canceled. So I'm wondering if Coastal Carolina is all that motivated when they wanted something bigger. Not going to bet Coastal Carolina. Moving into normal expected motivation, all the teams that I didn't mention. Right. If I didn't mention them, their motivation is expected to be right normal and where it's at. Obviously, the playoffs, but Notre Dame, Clemson, Ohio State, and Alabama are all going to be very motivated. So nothing there. Potentially high motivational spots. There's two of them. Both include Big Ten schools. The Transperfect Music City Bowl, Iowa versus Missouri. Iowa got screwed on this easier matchup. They're expecting something bigger here. And they get to play Missouri, who is really not a good SEC team at all. That's why you see them as a 14-point favorite. One thing about Iowa is that they haven't been practicing much due to COVID concerns. Another potentially high motivational spot is Indiana versus Ole Miss. Indiana got screwed over Iowa State, and Northwestern is playing in better bowls. You know, Indiana only had that. You know, they lost to Purdue that first game, and then they barely lost to Northwestern, and then they kicked the crap out of some other teams. They beat the heck out of Wisconsin, and now they're like, I'm in the Outback Bowl. You know, they wanted something better. And Indiana, Tom Allen, he's already mentioned that he's pissed. He's already tweeted about it. He says, you're damn right we're going to show up for this bowl. They're going to want to put one on Ole Miss here for being slighted. So same deal with Iowa and Indiana. At the same time, they didn't play a lot of games because of poor Big Ten leadership from Kevin Warren. So they have there's an extremely poor leader in the Big Ten, and it was more his fault than the committee's for putting them in bowl games because they didn't play a full schedule. So these teams are upset that they didn't get better bowls. At least Indiana only had one loss here, you know, and it was to Ohio State. Iowa, they had two losses, but I still expect both these teams to be pretty pissed off and want to put one on these teams. If you missed any of this, make sure you're a Free Picks newsletter subscriber, because I'm going to be sending the write-ups on the home field and the bowl game motivational spots within a day or two of this podcast. We have a long show for you today, so we're going to get right into my college bowl game picks, plays, and leans from December 24th through December 26th. Hit it! It's the most. December 24th, we have Hawaii versus Houston. Houston is minus 13. The total on this is 59.5. Hawaii, a great coach in Ty Graham this year. Great hire. This team has done very well compared to their expectations, beating teams like Nevada and Fresno State. You know, not a lot has changed with this team. They still play pretty fast at 76 plays per game. And they average a modest 26 points per game in kind of a defensive-oriented, slow-playing conference like the Mountain West. Houston, on the other hand, has started out with promise and failed to deliver. They are dead even in points per game at 32 on offense and defense, and the same with yards per play at 5.9. Houston also plays at an above-average pace of play under Dana Holgorsen. You know this, he's a fast player, 75 plays per game, and they are pretty turnover prone, one of the worst in the nation, minus one turnover per game. That gives the other teams great field position. My power ratings have this about a 10, a 10-point favorite for Houston. So a little bit of a lean to Hawaii, but I think that both teams are going to score, and I have a better idea of a play. Unless this gets past 14, I'm probably not going to play Hawaii. I like the total. Hawaii gives up 5.9 yards per play, 29 points per game on an easy schedule. I think that the over is certainly in play. We're going to take over 59.5. I gave this out. I actually took a bad number at 61.5, but I still like it, obviously, when it goes in my favor. Two-star premium shared play.
We're going to have the happiest Christmas since Bing Crosby tap dance with Danny fucking K.
Next game, Christmas Day, the Camellia Bowl. Buffalo versus Marshall, minus 3 is where it's kind of at. Dancing around minus 3 to minus 3.5. The total on this game is 53.5. This game should be called the Disappointment Bowl. Both of these teams lost their conference championship. Both of these conferences kind of suck at playing football. Marshall's a nice 1.6 yards per play, and Buffalo is a monstrous 2.5 yards per play. My power ratings has this game Buffalo by only 0.5 points, okay? But I can't bet Marshall, because we just saw Grant Wells having the yips at quarterback. Couldn't even complete a first half pass except to the UAB defense.
Unreal.
Yeah, had that over in the game, obviously. But anyways, he lost complete confidence. And it's hard to bet on that because who knows what we're going to get this game. I know their defense is really good. I really want to bet Buffalo here. But the coach, Doc Holliday, for Marshall, is 6-1 against the spread in bowl games. As a matter of fact, his first non-cover was last year. I might just watch this one, but I'm going to definitely lean under the 53.5 points to the total. December 26th, the Union Home Mortgage Gasparilla Bowl. South Carolina versus UAB. UAB minus 6. The total on this is 53. The fact that a two-win team is bad as South Carolina is actually in a bowl game over a team like Army was from the start. I believe Army just got slated in with West Virginia, thank God, is an absolute disgrace. UAB, much more respectable. They've just been so solid since they came back into the FBS. Blazers coach Bill Clark, he's got to have a Power 5 job soon. Pay that man some money, okay? Pay that man. And it's funny that you see UAB such a large favorite over an SEC team. It's very telling. In saying all this, this SEC team was at least in their game versus Ole Miss, and they did win against Auburn in overtime. I highly question the motivation, though, for them. And I don't think they care about being embarrassed, being that Muschamp was fired for South Carolina. On the other hand, I think the motivation's factored into the line, because my line is -4, and it's up to -6. I'm wondering where this line will go, but I have a strong lean to UAB here for sure. Next game, Coastal Carolina versus Liberty on December 26th as well. Liberty's +6.5. The total on this is 59. Liberty really hasn't played in a while. They had some COVID issues themselves. Their last game was November 27th against UMass, the worst team in football, with apologies to Bowling Green there. And you have to wonder if they're going to come out a little rusty. You know, I do wonder that. But, you know, on the other side of things, I think that this game is going to be a very good one to watch. You know, both teams have been on a tear this whole year. Liberty only has that 1-point loss against a very up-and-coming NC State team, right? I mean, they beat Virginia Tech, as we all saw in overtime. That field goal where you try to ice the kicker but was out of timeouts and gave them an extra 5 yards. And they beat Syracuse, because that's what people do. They just beat Syracuse. But I think Hugh Freeze deserves to get a Power 5 job for sure. I do. He's got to be back in the mix here. You know, what a nice comeback he's been making. I also know that Jamie Caldwell has just signed a new contract. He's been hounded by the media. But he decided to sign a long-term deal there, and he got paid. So good for Caldwell to stay at Coastal Carolina. Maybe he just doesn't want those big Power 5 jobs where, unless you recruit, you're never going to beat the big schools. It's very, very tough to do that with the 4 playoff system. You know, players don't want to go there. Starting out with the power ratings, I have Coastal Carolina 3.5 points better than Liberty. This makes the spread to me a bit high at 6.5. The schedules, Sagarin has Liberty ranking 140th in the nation, with Coastal at 108. All right, but I would argue that maybe Liberty had it just as hard as Coastal, playing 3 ACC teams and beating 2 of them. Right, that's a good argument. Passing favors Coastal Carolina some, but on the ground, Liberty has the edge at 5.7 yards per rush to Coastal's 5.0. yards per rush. So that's interesting. Total yards per play has Liberty +1.7 and Coastal +1.4. We must remember that Liberty fed off a lot of the horrible teams and bottom feeders, 2 FCS teams and Louisiana Monroe and FIU. So you do have to remember that. So they did get a little bit of a harder top of their schedule, but a very easy middle part of the schedule, right? Coastal got screwed, in my opinion, not having a New Year's Six Bowl. So they do have questionable motivation, as I said before. But this is too many points, in my opinion. You saw what Troy did to Coastal a couple weeks ago. I think Liberty can keep up with this team. I'm going to take the spread +6.5, 3-star premium play, and we're going to sprinkle the money line as well.
I just want to say one thing to my kid who should be home sleeping. Merry Christmas, kid!
You see what you did with this ball?
The Surf Pro First Responder Bowl, Louisiana versus UTSA, +13.5. The total on this is 57.5. This game is interesting because it's hard to gauge Louisiana's motivation. Not getting to play their conference championship, awarded the lovely status of co-champions. You know, it's like you won, but, you know, someone else did. You know, that's always fun. And I just wonder how they feel about that. And UTSA, they're going to be very motivated in this game for sure. You know, that Louisiana is a step up in competition. The Roadrunners have had some ups and downs this year. They got a lot of injuries this year. Second-string quarterback, it took him a while for Frank Harris, but he finally figured it out. UTSA is just great running the ball, 5.2 yards yards per rush. Well, Louisiana can do both very well, run the ball and defend. Louisiana's had the harder schedule, right? Much harder schedule, and they're a plus 1.6 yards per play to only plus 0.2 for UTSA. So not only they have the harder schedule, they have the much better yards per play. My power rings has this game almost at the spread due to Louisiana's stiff defense. They only allow 20 points per game on defense. I think if UTSA has a chance, it's going to have to be on the ground. I'm going to lean UTSA at plus the 13.5, but no play. And I'm going to lean under the 57.5 points. The Lending Tree Bowl. Western Kentucky versus Georgia State. Georgia State at minus 4.5. The total on this is 51.5. This Western Kentucky team was known for unders, right? They could not score at all year. But during their last two games, the Hilltoppers finally scored over 35 points in both of them when they could barely get to 20 points all year. You know, not sure if that was a fluke or not, because they played Charlotte and FIU. So have they gotten better? I don't know. I don't think so. I'm not sure. Georgia State, on the other hand, has been very good in the Sun Belt. They beat Georgia Southern, kept up with Louisiana and Appalachian State, single-digit losses against those two top teams. So both teams, very good against the run, allowing 4.2 yards per rush. And Georgia State's got the better offense, you know, than Western Kentucky, right? So that's why you see them favored, minus 4.5. The Panthers have had even yards per play. The Hilltoppers, minus 0.4. My power rings has Georgia State minus 3.5, so kind of on the spread here. But I do lean to the under. I think this total's a little too high for two defensive-minded teams. Georgia State's been playing a lot better defense this year. I lean under the 51, and even though my power rings don't say it, I'd probably lean Georgia State here. Western Kentucky, there's a chance they could just not score the ball much at all like they usually do. So I'm going to lean to them right now, but no play on that side. My friends, there were your December 24th through December 26th College Football Bowl games. Our next podcast next week is going to cover the Tuesday, December 29th through the 30th bowl games, and then the next episode next week for Wednesday/Thursday anyways, is going to cover December 31st through January 2nd, including the playoffs. So really excited to get more bowl games and plays ready for you. Without further ado, let's get into some NFL with our guest, Mr. Marco D'Angelo. And now I'm very excited to welcome back one of the best and most respected handicappers in all of Las Vegas. You've seen him and heard him many times on VSiN, watching Bet On It, Wager Talks podcast, and many radio stations across the nation. I'm pleased to welcome back Mr. Marco D'Angelo from WagerTalk.com. You can follow Marco on Twitter at Marco in Vegas. Merry Christmas, Marco. How's the holidays been treating you, my man?
Oh, great, Kevin. Thanks for that intro. When you started it, I thought, oh, I didn't realize we were having another guest on with me today. thanks for the kind words there, buddy.
Don't sell yourself short, buddy. You're one of the most respected. We appreciate having you very much, man. Big week going on. Lots of sports just flying at our heads, man. Back and forth. All of a sudden, there's bowl games. All of a sudden, they're playing them. I mean, what are we doing here? It's time to. I spent Sunday all the way till now barely sleeping, trying to handicap some of these games, and just kind of. I've had to put college basketball even on hold a little bit, man. How busy you been?
Oh, it's, you know, it's crazy, you know, having the start of the NBA season today as we're doing this podcast, trying to, you know, muddle through the college basketball and, you know, knock on wood. We've done very well so far. And, you know, and I'll be honest, December is probably my least favorite month of college basketball. I am a guy that, you know, I'm real big on conference play. And, you know, so December, you're trying to adjust to the new teams, trying to, you know, you're playing teams that you don't generally play. At least when you get to March Madness and you have that happen, you've got a whole body of work of a season to look at. Here we're trying to figure out who's going to be good, who's not. And then throw in the other little monkey in the wrench there. We got to deal with COVID. I study injury reports all the time, but, you know, now you've got to look at, you know, COVID protocols, who, you know, how many players are out, this or that. So it has been a challenge, but knock on wood, we're getting through and finding the winner. So that's always good, Kiev. But this has been a year like no other. I don't have to tell you that. And then throw the bowls in, and we're going to talk about that later in the podcast. Mm-hmm. That's a whole new way of handicapping this year as well. So fun times, but you know what? The beauty of it is, Kiev, is the books have to put up a number on every single game. They gotta take a stand. We as handicappers and bettors, we pay the tariff of 11 to 10. But we have the luxury of we don't have to play every game. Mm-hmm. We can pick and choose and try to find those spots where we feel they made a mistake, and we can, you know, get the edge over that 11 to 10 that they hold. And that's what, you know, is our strength for us. So it's a lot more work to find those edges this year, but it's worth it because on the same token, the poor books, they're battling everything the way we are too. They got to stay on top of COVID. You go into how many times this football season have you gone into a Saturday and had a play just absolutely wrecked when 2 hours before game time, the team announces five players are out and one of them's your quarterback? Yeah. That's not fun, buddy.
No, it's not. And it never happens on the other side of our tickets, does it? I mean, that's how it feels anyway. No, it's waiting all the way till the end has been obviously not the best thing to do. You want to get the lines early and I guess very late if it moves in your favor, but just to wait on this information has been tough. I guess the only edge that I somewhat found is I think the contract chasing holdouts have been a little bit of an overreaction. Not a lot of people that were, you know, close contact with people with COVID got it. So you kind of assume that they're going to come back and then you hit that before the line moves. That's pretty much the only thing that I found personally, man. But otherwise, yeah, been such a chore. So we're getting through it and hopefully we get past it. You know, I'm looking forward to springtime again and get past, hopefully the vaccine helps out a little bit here too. That's the goal. Well, let's look at the NFL then, Marco, and we're in week 16. Lots of things can happen. People are going to be making the playoffs. Teams are going to be missing the playoffs. What is different about handicapping week 16 and week 17 NFL games from the rest of the season?
Well, the first thing that I'm going to, you know, tell your listeners, Kiev, is don't overreact to the following phrase: must win situation. Okay. And everybody, you know, they love to say it. Hey, this team's in a must win, you know, and yeah, they are. But the reason they're in a must win is because they didn't play good enough all during the regular season to already have things locked up by week 16 or 17. So you're taking, you know, maybe a marginal, you know, club that, you know, is going to make the playoffs, but wasn't one of the dominant teams. But now because you've attached those must win to it, Vegas knows who you're going to bet. Okay. The general public is going to gravitate to the team in the must win situation because they feel they have the motivational edge. And maybe they do, but what we're going to talk about is a couple situations where I think you find extreme value. One, you're never getting the best of the number when you take these teams into must win because Vegas is going to make you pay the price for taking that team. Secondly, I like to look for situations where you can find a live dog. Teams that are out of the playoffs, they've got nothing to play for. You say, well, what do they care? Well, you know what? Misery loves company, all right? If I'm not going to the playoffs, but my division rivals come into town and they need to win this game to go to the playoffs, you know what? I am going to be sky high for that game. You know why? Because I want them to be miserable too. I'm not going to the playoffs. I don't want you going to the playoffs either. And that's where you will find some really good live dog situations because, A, they do have a motive, you know, something to be motivated about. The number is going to be in your favor because Vegas has skewed it to the team that needs to win. And obviously, that team that, you know, is already out of the playoffs probably has not been playing good and might have been playing even worse the last couple weeks because they've had nothing to play for. But then all of a sudden, you put a division rival on their schedule and you can play the role of spoiler. Well, then we'll use another phrase, and you saw it last night with the Cincinnati Bengals. That game becomes their Super Bowl. Yes. And they play out of their minds. And, you know, and then when things start going your way, it's like a snowball going down a big hill. It just gets bigger and bigger momentum. And you saw last night the Steelers were playing uphill that entire game last night. And the first half of that game might have been the worst half of football I've seen out of the Pittsburgh Steelers in the last 5 years. Oh. I mean, seriously, it was that bad. For the Steelers, they have zero running game, and we'll talk about the Steelers more when we cover that particular game. But, you know, it took everything I had, Kiev, for me to get through my plate of chicken wings watching that game last night. It was that upsetting to me. But, you know, I'm a gamer. You know, you never quit, you never give up, and you know, I was able to finish those wings. I know you were concerned about that.
Well, if a game's going to affect the way Marco finishes wings, then there's a serious issue with this team. That's all I know. But I was thinking about you watching that game, and I'm sitting there myself. Everything you said makes complete sense, and I was kicking myself. Why didn't I bet Cincinnati? Why didn't I take 14? Why didn't I do that? You know what I mean? I guess it's everybody gets caught up in this is the bounce back. You know, this is the Steelers have to get it. This is their get it right game. Bullshit. This was not their get it right. This was just another trap game, it seemed like. So, totally agree there. They probably even overlooked the Bengals a little bit. And the Bengals had a good game plan, got rid of the ball fast, didn't let TJ Watt affect it as much. And, the rest is history. Big Ben had a bad game. You're right. It was the worst first half of football that I've seen the Steelers play probably since the 90s or throughout my lifetime. Put it this way, I don't remember anything worse than that. So 100% agree with you there. Also, what I would like to add is some teams for week 17, and you know, obviously this should be obvious, won't be playing their starters if they clinch. Green Bay Packers won't. You know, somebody's going to look at that line when the Bears play the Packers, and as long as the Packers win this week against the Titans, of course. And I think, see, the Seattle game, I'm not sure if they need them to lose, but make sure you know if these teams clinch, because someone's going to look at that line and think it's awfully short, and it's going to be short for a reason. It's because Aaron Rodgers is not going to be playing that game. So remember to look for that as well. Sometimes being the team that has, like you said, a must win puts more pressure on their minds, and that's hard. You know, it's like they're going to come into this game and just feel like, what if I screw up? What if I screw up? And then they play tight, not their game, not throwing it down the field, and it blows up in their face. I've seen that happen multiple times. 100% agree with you, Marco.
It sounds like you're saying they play not to lose instead of playing to win, and that's not very advantageous to laying points with a team.
No, it is not. 100% agree with you. Well, who are your top five power-rated teams then? And, you know, maybe 3-4 weeks ago you might have had the Steelers up there, but I'm not sure where you have them today. Who you got?
Yeah, they're not in the top five. I am going to surprise you with one of them.
Okay.
That I have in the top five. And one of the teams that I have in the top five. Okay, let's end the suspense. Number one is Kansas City, okay?
Right.
I do have them as the number one team. I look at this team and, you know, it's amazing. What have they – I think they've gone now six straight games where they failed to cover the spread, but yet they've won all of the games. Do you know how hard that is to do in the NFL? Because the league average, where the winner of the game covers the spread over, it's normally between 82 and 83% history of the NFL. And then that number goes up actually in the playoffs a couple percentage points. But for Kansas City to win six straight games and fail to cover the spread in all of them, that tells you how much of a tariff is being put on them by the odds makers, because they know everybody wants to bet them. What it also tells me is when I watch this team, and I do a show every week out of Nebraska, which obviously Kansas City is, you know, the team that's closest pro team to them, and we do their games every week. I say when I watch them, it's almost like they're bored. They ran to the Super Bowl last year. They got the job done after a couple years of getting close and then having New England, you know, break their hearts, you know, in a championship game and so forth, an AFC championship game. The fact that they finally did it last year, now coming to go through the whole season and go through what is just an unprecedented year, and I hate to overuse that word because everybody, that's probably a word that's been used more this year than in the history of the world that it's been around, but it is unprecedented times, and I just feel that they're bored. And the next thing you know, you look up and it's a 3-play 70-yard drive and they regain the lead, and they just find a way to win. So when they get to the playoffs, they shouldn't be bored, and you should see the real Chiefs from beginning to end. So they are the best team. The number two team, I have the Saints. And that's because I think the Saints overall, when healthy, now that's key, because we saw last week Drew Brees came back, but he wasn't 100%. Okay, so now I'm counting on these last couple weeks that he's going to get better each week and get back close to what he was for most of the season from the rib injury. But you look at the defense, this defense is good. You can't run on them. The other thing you look at, they have a passing game when Brees is healthy. They have a running game no matter whether he's healthy or not. And then Taysom Hill is good in his role, not his role as a backup, but his role of Sean Payton's love affair with, you know, bringing him in all the time on different plays. Sometimes I really think that it just breaks it breaks your own momentum. I know it gives the defense something else to look at, but your team just went rolling down the field, and now you're inside the 10-yard line and you're running a gimmick play with Taysom Hill. It just frustrates me sometimes. But Sean Payton has done it for several years. He's gotten away with it. Top to bottom, I think they are the most complete team offensively and defensively. Next comes Green Bay. They're number three. And obviously this is on the offensive side, where they're heavy with their strength. It's Aaron Rodgers. The defense is still suspect. I think a team that can run the football can have success against Green Bay. The problem is, because Aaron Rodgers is so good and can score so fast, that generally speaking, unlike last week's game, which Green Bay, I don't know what the hell they were doing in the second half, but you jump out to a 21-3 lead, that's supposed to take the other team out of their running game, because they've got to try to throw the football to get back into the game. So you can cover up a weakness that, you know, maybe can't, that Green Bay has. But again, offensively, if you're going to go toe to toe, they're right there with Kansas City for one of the best offenses. And as far as quarterbacks making big plays, there's no question he's right there, him and Mahomes. So I put them at three. Now, four and five are maybe the two that might be a surprise. Five is definitely going to be, because I have my fifth-ranked team, and I'll give you a second to think about it, is not even in playoffs right now. Yeah. Number four is the Buffalo Bills. This is a team that has done a complete role reversal from the year before. Coming into this season, the narrative was, We want to see Josh Allen, you know, take a step forward. This team cannot win playoff football only averaging, you know, 19 or 20 points a game. The defense has carried them and carried them. The offense has got to step it up. Well, my God, have they stepped it up. Josh Allen's having a great, great season. And honestly, when you talk about value to a team, when you talk about an MVP candidate, he will never get the votes, okay? But I got to tell you, yes, Mahomes is everything to the Chiefs, but he's got so many weapons. Yes, Aaron Rodgers is everything to Green Bay. For the Buffalo Bills, because their defense that was so good the year before, you know, the last several years and carried the team, has not carried them at all this year. Their defense is actually bad. Josh Allen has had to do it offensively, and I think that this team wouldn't even have made the playoffs if he would get hurt. This team's not a playoff team, pure and simple. So for me, that's the definition of MVP. I like the Bills. They're going to make some noise with a lot of teams. They can run the football and passing the football. Josh Allen has been just superb this year. You know, yes, he got beat in the Kansas City game, but again, that's Kansas City, and every team but one is, you know, lost to Kansas City this year. So I put them in at number four. The number five team, you want to go ahead and tell me who it is?
Cleveland, right?
That would be good guess. I have them actually seventh. But I have the Baltimore Ravens fifth. I think that this is a team that has fallen off people's power radar simply because that stretch they had in the middle there. This is a team that when they lost that first Pittsburgh meeting, a game that they never should have lost. They had a 200-yard difference offensively in that game. They dominated the Steelers. And it was Lamar Jackson's worst game. As good as he was for the first half of that game, he was horrible the rest of the game. And the turnovers turned that game around. And Pittsburgh stole that game from Baltimore. And it's a game that, as a fan, I was very happy. As a professional sports bettor, I was very pissed, to be honest, because I had a lot of money on Baltimore that day.
Bet against your Steelers, man. That's a no-win situation, buddy. Especially,
I love the Steelers. I tell my wife, I love her. I love the Steelers, but I love money, and I had an affair with money for a long time. You know, she's always been there. You know, I never, you know, break up with her. And when I can make money, that's going to take front and center. And that particular day, Baltimore was the right side for where my money was.
The first game, the first matchup, right?
The first matchup.
Yeah,
yes.
And I agree. And they outgained Pittsburgh that game too,
by over 200 yards. Yeah. But if you look at it after that game, Baltimore was not the same for a month. And in the midst of that month, they had all of the COVID issues too. So this is a team that's fallen off the radar that right now. And I know, you know, they beat Jacksonville last week. So what? You know, and they beat Dallas the week before that. So what? It's just the way they beat them. Yeah, there's a lot of teams that beat bad teams, but they just show up and get by. They showed up and beat the snot out of both teams. And this is a team that's peaking at the right time. And if they sneak their way into the playoffs, like I said, right now they're on the outside looking in, but I think they have a really good shot of sneaking in. This is a team that I don't think anybody would want to play in the playoffs. And I could tell you this much. If Baltimore makes the playoffs and you ask people, who would you rather face, Baltimore or Pittsburgh? Right now, they're going to say, I would rather face Pittsburgh. And it's Pittsburgh that was an 11-0 team just 3 weeks ago.
Man. I'm not too far from you, but I have Baltimore tied for fifth as well. And yeah, great points there. I have the Steelers, I think, sixth. Where do you have the Steelers? sixth or eighth, something like that?
I got Steelers down to eight now.
Okay. And I bet against the Bears and the Badgers plenty of times. So I feel you on the whole affair with money thing, you know. When they're favorites, you can bet against them. They can still win, and you can get a double win, right? So that's always fun.
And, you know, then, you know, I call, you know, people talk about, you know, in situations, you know, if you have like a, you know, a three-team parlay and, you know, you got two of them in and, you know, you got the last leg, do you hedge a little bit? Or, you know, if you got a teaser going live, you know, into that Sunday night game, do you, you know, hedge a little on the other side and play for the middle? You know, those are all, you know, they all make sense. They're all profitable plays. Well, here, if you bet against your, you know, the team you root for all the time, it's an emotional hedge. I'm either going to make money and be happy, or I'm going to lose money but be happy as a fan.
Absolutely. I have the exact same philosophy here, man. And I'm number one KC for sure. They are bored a lot, and you see that. They really outgained us, the Saints. That was my push last week. I had a great NFL week, and I did take them minus three because I was like, when are you going to see KC minus three again? You might not even see that in the Super Bowl. So I took them.
That's twice now that Kansas City, they did the same thing in the Tampa Bay game. You know,
right,
where the
right.
Tampa Bay game, they lost by, you know, a half because I had Tampa in the hook. And that was one of those ones that made up for Baltimore. That was a wrong side winner.
Right. Exactly. And Casey's been known for that, unfortunately. But I have Green Bay number two and Buffalo number three for all the reasons that you stated. Right. I have the Rams at number four. And I think it's more because of Sean McVay. I think Jared Goff's playing above his talent level, and that might show its ugly head in the playoffs. We'll see. And number five, I have the Saints and Baltimore tied in my power rating. So you can put whichever one you want there. My problem with the Saints is Michael Thomas just his injury took him out for the year, as from what I just heard on a report yesterday. So I'm worried about that. Emmanuel Sanders can step it up, though. I'm not super concerned, but man, Thomas was just such a beast for stretching the field with that team. Get rid of the Taysom Hill stuff. You're not fooling anybody anymore. So we'll see what happens in the playoffs if they can finally get it done. Let's get on to, well, you know, I guess my question is, Kansas City, let's just ask this. Do they have are they the ones that are going to win the Super Bowl? Or do you think another team might sneak in? Or is there a team that might have some value as a long shot from the betting market?
Well, the obvious thing is it's Kansas City's to lose, okay? Let's, you know, be honest about it and not try to super outsmart anybody. But we're here to look for value, okay? There is no value betting Kansas City. That ship has, you know, left the station. They're, you know, prohibitive favorite to win the Super Bowl right now. And if you're taking a futures ticket on Kansas City right now, you know, you really shouldn't be betting, okay? You should have made that bet a long time ago when there was still a little bit of value with them or way back at the beginning of the season. Where there is value, if you want to take a flyer, and I'll give you one team from each side. AFC, if they get in, like I said, Baltimore is going to be a team that people don't want to play. And if they do get into the playoffs and sneak in, how ironic would it be to make a run to the AFC championship game with 3 weeks ago looked like they weren't even going to be a playoff team after last year being the best team in football record-wise and get sent home in the first week. Mm-hmm. I think this team's playing with a chip on their shoulder. They've got nothing to lose, and we've seen it in so many sports that if they do run the table and get in, the fact that they had to win their way in the whole way, and I said about at the beginning, it's going to sound like it's counterproductive of what I said. Well, if you're in a must-win situation this late, it's because you weren't that good. Baltimore's different because Baltimore went through something with not only injuries, but the COVID situation. And that's something that we've never dealt with before. So, you know, they have an excuse for why things were bad for a few weeks. Now they're peaking at the right times. And remember a few years ago in baseball when the St. Louis Cardinals had to win their way in on the final day of the season, and they parlayed that right to the World Series. You know, it's just when you have that momentum, it's I would rather have a team going into the playoffs with momentum like that than somebody that had it clinched 4 weeks ago and has been on cruise control and now has to flip the switch for the playoffs, a la like Baltimore last year.
All right.
It doesn't always work. So AFC sleeper is Baltimore for me. NFC, we're on, you had them higher. You had them in your top five. I had them just on the outside, and that is the Rams. And the only knock on the Rams is Jared Goff in the big game, okay? Until we see him consistently be able to perform in the spotlight, that's the hang-up with this team. Offensively, they've got a lot of talent. Offensively, game planning, he's one of the brightest minds in the game. So there's a huge advantage coaching-wise in most of the matchups. Defensively, the Rams are the real deal. You got a team that can bring pressure on the quarterback with that, you know, front line. And, you know, you've got one of the best, defensive linemen in the game. You've got a secondary with Ramsey that can shut down, take away the opposing team's best receiver. I like that with the Rams. We saw Goff in a few big games this year play well. He had the Monday night game against the Bears. Granted, it was the Bears, but he played super. He had the other Monday night game against Tampa where he went spotlight, only game on, Monday night football, all eyes are on you, and who are you playing? Yeah, you're playing the guy, Tom Brady, that denied you a Super Bowl just a couple years ago. Granted, it was with another team, but it was still Tom Brady, and you're going to be compared to him throughout that game, and he delivered in that one. So those are signs that makes me like the Rams. And after last week losing to the Jets, you're going to get all kinds of value if you want to take a flyer right now with the Rams, because their stock definitely dropped after last week. And it's just one of those games, you know, don't make too much out of it, okay? Clearly they looked right past the Jets, and they got caught with their pants down. Plain and simple.
100%. And Buffalo, you're not going to get a ton of value with right now. They're at plus 900, I think, 9-1. That's just a money line rollover might be better for you. I mean, they're going to be dogs 2-1 versus the Chiefs probably, right? In Kansas City, I mean, plus 7 probably is going to be what you're looking at. Plus 6, plus 7, and that's close to 2-1. So, yeah, you're not going to get a lot of value with that. I agree with you, and I was going to say the loser of the Rams versus the Seattle game this weekend might have some value. And I everything you said about the Rams with McVay, this could be their year. Maybe they get over the hump. The Rams have that complete defense and shut down cornerbacks. Love that. Love Aaron Donald. 100% agree with that. But Seattle's got the quarterback that might be able to go toe for toe with Kansas City. And maybe that's what you need. Maybe you need that super quarterback that can do that. And the only one that I know of is him, maybe Aaron Rodgers. But the knock against the Packers is that they give up a lot against the run. Game we're not going to talk about, Tennessee. I am concerned about the Packers defense against Derrick Henry right there. And that's an interesting one I'm still looking at. Great stuff, man. Let's get into a few games then, shall we?
Let's do it.
All right. Well, starting with San Francisco versus the Arizona Cardinals. Arizona, when I wrote this down, is -3.5, and the total's at 49. And this thing's already up to 4 again. It started at 4, and it's just kind of bounced there. This is one of those situations you mentioned, though, Marco. So I'm going to let you go first.
Yeah, well, lucky for you, I'm seeing that it's looking like now C.J. Beathard is going to be the quarterback and not my buddy Mullins. And because if it was still going to be Mullins, I was going to have to say to you, on the advice of my therapist, that I have to pass this game because for my mental health, I cannot bet Nick Mullins anymore this season. I've had them the last 2 weeks, and it has been absolutely atrocious. Oh, the performance that he has had the last 2 weeks. It's insane what he has done in the turnovers. The man cannot hold on to the football, whether he's throwing an interception or getting hit and fumbled. It's been ridiculous. The 49ers outgained both of their opponents the last 2 weeks by a large amount and yet lost both games. Seven turnovers will do that in 2 weeks. And these are not just turnovers. He's got pick sixes in there. He's got scoop and scores in there. He's got fumbling deep in his own territory in there. It has been ugly. And, you know, 2 weeks ago against Washington, they were playing. It was a home game for the Niners there in Arizona in Glendale, your backyard. They dominated that game. They only gave up 193 yards of offense to the Washington Redskins in that game. And if you looked at just the numbers and the stats, first downs, total yardage, you would have thought the 49ers won by, you know, 2-3 scores. Instead, they lose by 8, and they gave up not one, but 2 defensive touchdowns in the game. That was the difference. So, you know, against my better judgment, I came back with them last week against Dallas because Dallas is pitiful. Let's not get excited about their 2-game winning streak. We'll talk about them later. This is a team that's not good. And, you know, Zeke Elliott wasn't going to play. Everything's shaped up for a 49er bounce back on the road. Well, they outdid themselves. They had 3 turnovers the week before. They had 4 this week. And they had a touchdown on an onside kick they gave up and still managed to make it only an 8-point loss. So very frustrating for 49er backers the last 2 weeks. Now you get C.J. Beathard. Can't be any worse. It's, you know, we've seen this year whoever the next man up is seems to add a spark to the team, a la Finley last night. For me, I love this Arizona team. I've used them several times this season. I had them in a big, big teaser last week against Philadelphia. I thought the spot was right. And bam, they roll out to a big lead right away. Fumbled the ball. Even after fumbling the ball, you know, inside the 5 and I think the opening drive when they, you know, could have had another score. But what did they do like they do so often? They let teams hang around. And, you know, between the costly turnovers and let a team hang around, teams, you know, they get brave. You know, you don't put them away early. They're going to come back to bite you. And Philadelphia, give them credit. They never quit last week. And Jalen Hurts, he probably sealed the fate of Carson Wentz in Philadelphia. If Carson Wentz didn't seal it for himself running his mouth, this is a team that I just can't trust as a favorite. And San Francisco is a dangerous dog here. I got Arizona winning the game, but I got this as a 3-point game. Another one, they come right down to the wire, which it seems like happens way too often in Arizona games. I can't lay points with them this week. As bad as the 49ers have looked, I just can't do it. And San Francisco should be getting used to playing in Glendale, even though this is a road game. It, you know, they've played 2 home games here. So you put the gun to my head. I'm on San Francisco again, but I know my clients don't want to hear the words 49ers.
I imagine, man. Well, it's funny. I didn't know that Beathard was going to start or potentially going to start. Did they announce that today?
I am seeing it on my injury list in starting quarterbacks. They are showing Beathard right now, and they're usually when they make the switch, they're 90 to 95% correct. So, and really, how can you How can you go to Mullins again?
I don't know. He ranks the worst in QBR out of all the quarterbacks right now. All the starting quarterbacks, he's the worst. He's a turnover machine. I don't know what the hell happened to him. I've lost games because of him. You know, you also see him like – I've also lost bets when he's done good too against like – what was it, the Giants? I don't remember. One of those teams he just destroys and then just looks – absolutely incompetent. And then all of a sudden he beats the Rams. You know, it's like, what is that? You know, it is a division game, like you said.
Yep.
The thing with me is that, and it's, I like the Cardinals here and my number's 5, but the Beathard thing does throw a slight wrench in it, but I don't know if Beathard's better than Mullins. And I expect some problems. They lost just so much. I mean, I understand if Deebo Samuel was playing, but Brandon Ayuk's been really picking it up. But, man, the Niners are hurt on their offensive line. Mostert can't stay healthy. He's getting banged up. They're down to pretty much one somewhat healthy guy in Wilson as far as a running back. Their defense isn't what it used to be. You saw Dallas shred them last week. The Dallas freaking Cowboys, you know, they made the game close because of a Hail Mary catch last week. That was it. I was like, man, if you didn't give out that last touchdown, you could have tied it up with that Hail Mary catch, you know?
And, absolutely. But one other stat to throw at you with Arizona, and granted, we're seeing the changing of the guard with Arizona because, you know, they haven't been a favorite that often. Last 3 years, they've only been a home favorite 9 times. They're 1-8 against the spread as a home favorite.
Oh, dear. That's not a good trend. But I know that they are at least 3-0 against the Niners their last 3 games against the spread.
Yeah.
So that's the only.
But they've been a dog. They've been a dog.
They have been a dog pretty much every single time. Yeah, absolutely every single time. So I'm going to play the Cardinals small. Because it helps with my emotions as well, because the Bears are trying to fight for the playoffs. So let's just look at it like that, my man. I took the 3.5 is where I wrote it down. I like it to 4, but I'm not going to take it. I would not take it at 4.5, 5. It's such a slight change in percentage from 4 to 4.5. I know that, but my number was 5, 5.5. So I was barely over the point 2.38 anyway, you know? So in my opinion, a smaller play in Arizona for 1.5 or so is probably adequate for just a free play I'm giving up. Plus, they have a lot of upside, at least with that offense. The Niners, they should be motivated here, but the C.J. Beathard changed quarterback. Who the hell knows what's going to happen there? Next game, Miami versus the Las Vegas Raiders. The Vegas is +2.5. The total on this is 47, Marco. Miami, very nice surprise this year to a lot of people. I'm kind of pissed. I did bet them last week against the Pats, but I bet them week one, and I thought they should have beat the Pats week one, and everyone's saying, oh, the Pats are better with Newton. Yeah, well, how'd that turn out? Not too well. Yeah. Vegas has shown flashes. I mean, they beat the Chiefs, you know, and then they lose outright to the Falcons and almost to the Jets. It's like this team is so Jekyll and Hyde, you know. It blows my mind. The Carr injury does throw a wrench into the spread for me. But at the same time, the Dolphins have a lot of wide receivers that are banged up. And I'm really curious if Parker is going to come back and play in a couple out of those dudes. Derek Carr is not completely ruled out, but to be honest with you, I almost would rather see Mario to start this game. I think Gruden can get creative with him. Gruden did have some boneheaded goal line plays that could have took care of the game if he did the read option with Joey Bosa out last week. It's like, why are you not read option then? But he doesn't and screws it up. But at least when he has some time to practice with Mariota, Mario can be a dangerous quarterback, and that's kind of what the Dolphins are. Could be a weakness, too, is the running quarterback. Josh Allen took care of him pretty well. Miami let down spot for sure. I mean, they beat the Patriots at home. But one thing about the Raiders, they can't stop a thing. They cannot stop anything. You know, laying points with the Raiders is been a pretty bad situation. I've got caught up in it a few times over the last 5 weeks, but Mario is going to be a wild card here, and I think the Raiders they're going to put up some points, and I also see the Dolphins putting up some points. One stat I like, and I know the Dolphins are pretty good under team 5-9, but the Raiders are 10-3-1 to the over this year, and I don't have to worry about too much weather going on in the dome there with Allegiant. So Gruden's going to dial up some plays to confuse Flores. I like the over. I do. I think over 47 is a little low. So I'm going to give that for 2 stars in a play. What are your thoughts?
Well, I agree with you. The number they put up on this game looks low considering what the Raiders have been doing. But I'm going to point out, and just, you know, to make the observation, there should be a little bit of improvement on the Raiders' defense this week. They fired the defensive coordinator before last week's game. And last week's game was on a Thursday. I really was surprised that they made a big switch like that on a week where you're fighting for your playoff life and you only have a 4-day, you know, week for prep. You're playing on a Thursday. You know, you really can't put anything new in or make wholesale changes with the defense with a new defensive coordinator when you're playing in 4 days. Now you've got the flip side of that because they played on a Thursday. It is the second week with a new defensive coordinator, and you've had 10 days to work on whatever he wants to change. And God knows you should change just about everything because this defense, as you said, has been god-awful. With that said, as bad as the defense has been, and we've seen totals of 52, 52.5, 52.5 again, 56.5. Why did they bring this total out at 47? It's almost like they're begging you, here, please, free money, Merry Christmas, take this over. I mean, you don't see a Raider game in the 40s this year because of that defense. And that tells me that I think they're anticipating a little bit of improvement from the Raiders. And Miami's MO is their defense is pretty good. Surprisingly, if you look at what Miami has done, the last 6 weeks, they've held 5 out of their 6 opponents to 21 points or less. The only opponent that got more than 21 points was Kansas City, who happens to score a lot of points on every team they play. So, I look at this Miami defense, and that's what's been the biggest surprise to me. Everybody talks about Tua. You know, I wasn't a fan of the move to when they went to him. I didn't understand it. This was a team that was playing well with Fitzpatrick. They were on the cusp of getting into the playoffs, and they made a change. It was like it was a predetermined thing that on this particular week, we're going to go to Tua. But they haven't missed a beat since. I don't know if it's that extra dynamic he brings to the game, with his running ability, because that's definitely not something that's in Fitzpatrick's, you know, wheelhouse, you know, to scramble and make big plays that way. But as far as a pure passer goes, Fitzpatrick is light years ahead of Tua at this point of careers. So I questioned the move. So you're not going to generally get a lot of points out of Miami. Their offense is more, you know, let's ground and pound. Last week against New England, who has a very good defense, 42 rushes in that game, 250 yards on the ground against the Bill Belichick defense. And, you know, I was involved in that game last week. I've done very well this year with teasers, and I just thought that New England with their defense, even as bad as Cam has played, their defense keeps them in games. Getting New England over a touchdown with the teaser, I thought was gold. And then that late touchdown in the fourth quarter. I mean, that game was, you know, back and forth, you know, a 3 to 4 point game either way. They kept changing leads. And then Miami finally got the lead again and then got the last touchdown to get it over all of the numbers. And that, you know, was, you know, a kick in the southern region there late in the game on that one. But I don't trust the Raiders. But for me, I've got Miami winning this game. If you ask me where I wanted to play it, I think it's going to be a little bit of a lower scoring game. I think this total is sending a warning sign in Vegas. You know, Vegas, especially here in Vegas, think about this. We saw this factor in with the Golden Knights where the Raiders would get a lot of play. And when the Golden Knights were getting all of their play, it was they were getting two things. They were betting them on the money line, and they were betting them on the puck line. And then they were taking the over in all of the games. They were getting a lot of action. It was all the time. Well, with the Raiders, they still get that, you know, the betting on the Raiders. But the fact that the public's been losing with the Raiders, it's slowing down. What's not slowing down is the public is betting the over every week. And so for Vegas to bring it out low, knowing who the John Q's going to bet tells me something that they really do suspect this number to be this game to be lower than they've seen in the past, because 47 is begging it. And I hate to debate you on your play, but I really look at numbers and say, hey, man, something just doesn't smell right here. And this one, this 47 smells like 3-day-old fish in the summertime.
Hey, I appreciate you being honest. That's more important than, you know, trying to agree with someone every single time. Thank you for that. You know, the thing that I looked at is I think the running game is going to happen with Miami, and I think they're going to get chunks of 5 to 7 yards every time they do it. That's I think they should score pretty quickly. I know they run the clock when that happens, but that was part of my handicap as well. I have a question. Is Henry Ruggs going to play? Is he going to be off COVID protocol?
That is something we don't have the answer to yet. I would say, based on what we've seen in the past with other players, that he will play.
Right.
That he's going to make it through the, you know, the time, and you know, and unless there's a relapse, I think he's going to make the protocol and be cleared to play for Saturday.
All right. Well, we're going to bet a sandwich on this then, Marco. If this is Mariota's time to shine and to prove to somebody he could be a quarterback, starting quarterback in the NFL, he blows this one. There's not going to be a whole lot of room for that anymore. We'll see what happens. If you're right, 47's low, but you've talked me into looking for the buyback at some point, and I think this thing's going to get up to 50, Marco.
Game day, the public's going to come in. There's only one way they're going to play, and especially if, you know, we get to Saturday, and as you said at the top, Carr's not ruled out yet. So, you know, there is still a chance we see Carr. And if they do announce Carr officially as the starter, I think you will see that. And then, yeah, you could buy out of it and have a couple point middle.
What's funny is I think the over's even got a better chance with Mariota than Carr. Believe it or not, I think Mariota just this game is going to throw the wrinkles in their defense. It's just I don't like Carr against the Miami as much, but so much interesting to happen. Best practices is always try to predict a number and where it's going to go, and if it goes past your number, you can pass by 2.4%. percentage points of chance you buy back. So that's the way I try to bet my games. And over the years, I've done all right. So good stuff, man. Great handicap on that game. Great explanation, too. So I appreciate that. Let's move on to this game. And, oh, man, I'm going to give you the floor, Marco, because you take some heart pills if you have to, or, you know, maybe have a drink, but we're going to talk about the Indianapolis Colts versus the Pittsburgh Steelers. And Pittsburgh changed from a -2.5 juice to hell all the way down to +1, +2. I'm seeing it. What a change in spread here after one night, a date with the Bengals. Total on this game is 44.5, man. What do you have?
Oh, Kiev, you've heard me say numerous times on shows and things that I've done, you know, when you're watching ball games, don't overreact to one game. No team is ever as bad as their worst game, or are they ever as good as their best game. And, you know, we've got to say that here. Now, did Pittsburgh look bad? They absolutely did. They looked as, you know, I commented, that was the worst half of football I might have seen in 5 years out of the Steelers. Even last year, when they didn't have Ben and the offense looked atrocious at times, the defense was keeping them in ball games. They were bad on both sides of the football. Now, anybody that's been, you know, watching our show that I do with Kelly and Vegas Renner, they know that I've been preaching about the Steelers' defense is going to be in decline. I've been preaching about it for a month. The injury to Bud Dupree was huge. And it was huge on so many different levels where people don't understand. When you start talking about cluster injuries at a certain position, you really got to put a bigger note on the impact of that injury because it affects everybody else. People forget the Steelers already lost an all-pro linebacker early in the season when Devin Bush was hurt and lost for the season. Then, you know, a month ago, they lose Bud Dupree. So they lost their inside linebacker, they lost their outside linebacker. And what that did now is you've got other players playing positions that, you know, half of the field, the middle and, you know, in the other outside. But more importantly, Dupree and TJ Watt were one of the most prolific pass duo combos in the NFL this year as far as sacks go. And the reason being is because when you have two pressure guys, one coming from each side, it creates blocking problems for opposing teams. You can't, you know, double team both of them. You know, if you double team both of them, somebody's coming right up the middle because there's nobody there to do things. So it always was leaving one of them in single coverage, and they're hard to handle blocking, especially TJ Watt. Whenever he would be in, you know, a single blocking scheme, he was just, you know, bull rushing his defender and getting to the quarterback. Well, now they don't have that threat, so it'll limit watch TJ Watt's sack numbers. You're going to see them decline because in pressures and hits on the quarterback simply because he's going to get double teamed every play. And that presents a problem for the defense because they're not getting the pressure on the quarterback that they had. Then throw in there. Now he did come back last night, Joe Hayden, but Hayden missed in the secondary a couple games with a concussion. So that was another key player out of the lineup for that defense. And last night they just got torched. The problem with the Steelers' defense also is being compounded right now by the fact they can't run the football offensively, so they're not staying on the field long. What they were doing is either scoring quickly with a big pass play when everything was clicking, or as you saw last night in that first quarter, how many three and outs did the Steelers have in no time off the clock? And your defense is right back out on the field. You can't play football that way. I don't care how good your defense is, you're going to wear them out. And then add in all the injuries, that's what's happened to the Steelers. And then throw in that they did play, and that's why a lot of people said last night was the so-called get-right game, because they were playing an opponent that they should have been able to run the football against. The Cincinnati Bengals ranked 26th against stopping the run. You also had, for the first time in a month, a full week of prep for the Steelers. Prior to this week's game, the three previous games were played over a 12-day period. Three games in 12 days. And those three games weren't just any games. They were your biggest rival, the Baltimore Ravens, which is always a physical bloodbath, and you had to play that game on a Wednesday, and then you come back and play a game on a Tuesday the next week after that physical game, play a short week, you know, and then, you know, come back and then play Sunday night game. They've played just, it was ridiculous, the schedule that they had. It took its toll. Now the season's on the line. Is this worth this much of a swing? And remember, you said open 2.5. If you go before last week's games were played, the Westgate does the look-ahead lines. Westgate had them a 3-point favorite before last week's games were played. And then after Indianapolis did play, it came out at 2.5, just a half point different. But then after last night, we seen the full swing. So you're telling me that this is off of one game, and yeah, there was one injury in the game last night, but not significant. Four and a half point move off of one game? That's absolutely ridiculous. Do I want to take the Steelers and do I trust them right now? I don't, but I don't trust Indianapolis to be laying points on the road. Because of where this line has moved and what it is, and because they have been so profitable this year, Kiev, is this is a plus EV teaser. This would have been a plus EV teaser no matter who was favored to get it through the 3, the 4, and the 7. This will be a tightly contested ball game. I don't see Phillip Rivers getting separation on the Steelers in this game. And, you know, as Chuck Noll used to say all the time after a bad game, we need to get back to basics. Well, the Steelers need to do that, and Mike Tomlin's got to channel his inner Chuck Noll this week and light a fire under this team. But if I get to the window on this game, it's going to be with a teaser on the Steelers, getting them over the touchdown. And I think this line will continue to climb a little bit. You know, when you talk about a four-point move, four and a half, when you're moving from one side of zero to the other side of zero, it's not the same as a four-point move on normal numbers where you're going from maybe, you know, 2 to 6, you know, because then you're going through 3s and 4s. You're still just trying to pick the winner basically in the game. So don't get overly hyped up about it, but where it does present the value is now we have a team that should have been laying 2.5 points 7 days ago or 24 hours ago, and now with the use of a teaser, we're going to get that team that was -2.5 to now be getting them +7.5 or 8 points. That's a lot of value for me in a game that should be a low-scoring game. I will take the teaser and tease the Steelers up. I will have them on some plays. And that's something, you know, for your listeners, I know you've probably, you know, educated them a million times. The lower the total, the more important the points are in the game. So when you get a plus EV teaser, and by plus EV teaser, I'm saying your 6-point teaser moves you through all the key numbers of 3, 4, 6, and 7, it becomes that much more valuable when you've got a low total.
You stole my thunder, Marco, because that's part of one of my plays that I'm giving out. Oh, man. Great. Absolutely. Lower total, tease the +2 dog every single time. And, you know, the Steelers, they are missing linebackers. They've been, but they're starting to figure it out, in my opinion, with their younger guys coming in, some of the second string. That happens. The first couple games is rough, but their defense is going to stand up. And I know the Colts are hot and the Steelers are not, but this was too much of a line move right now. I might see myself with a Steelers ticket at some point when the dust settles. But for now, I'm teasing the Steelers +1.5 with the Chicago Bears down to -1.5, my man. And
you're still in my thunder now.
So there you go. Great minds, like they say. So the Bears, we'll get into that game, but this is going through the key numbers, like you said, the 7, the 3, the 6, the 4 is somewhat key as well. So huge value on those teasers. And this is our refuse to lose teaser. We are 9-6 this year so far in our free refuse to lose teasers. So we stole each other's thunder. So I think I know where you're going with the next game, Marco. The Bears versus Jacksonville. The total is 47. One thing I will say is that right now, the Bears are not who we thought they were. According to Denny Green.
This has been 3 times now, though. At the beginning of the season, whenever they were 5-2 or 5-1, you know, they're not what you think they are. Yeah. And then we get Nick Foles. Everybody wanted Nick Foles. We got Nick Foles. They weren't any better. And so, you know, yeah, well, they are who we thought they are. They still stink with Nick Foles. Now, all of a sudden, we got Trubisky in there, and they're winning again. And love them or hate them, and I've hated them more than I've loved them, and I know you're a Bears fan, so you've had to go through this whole growing process with Trubisky. I was never high on him getting drafted as, you know, with their first pick the way they did with him. This is a guy that, what'd he play, 13 college football games, and his stock rose that much out of a conference that doesn't know how to spell defense.
Right. Yep. And North Carolina. It was an awful pick. We don't have to, we don't have to revisit that.
But they're 5-2 with him as a starter this year.
I'll tell you what happened, Marco. They fixed their offensive line. They got guys like Alex Bars and Sam Mustafer, who played for Notre Dame. Undrafted Sam Mustafer now is the leader of the offensive line. What? Yeah, you know, the Bears lost not Cody White. They lost James Daniels. They lost Bobby Massey. And then it took a while. Then they kind of moved Whitehair from center to guard, and they figured it out. Now they're run blocking, and Montgomery's getting a ton of yards. I haven't seen this run blocking in years, man. Since Walter Payton, maybe. Jesus. I don't know what the hell's been going on. And this is what I've been wanting to see. And now Bill Lazor, knock, knock, what fans have been screaming at you to do, roll out Mitch Trubisky into play action. He's terrible and nervous in the pocket. When he's on his feet, he can throw the ball accurately. He can get first downs. Do that all the time. I mean, that's what they do with Goff, you know? It's like, how did it take you 12 weeks to figure this out? My God, man. Gonna have a heart attack.
You've hit the nail on the head. The last four games since he's taken over, they've rushed for 122, 140, 169, and last week 199. They're getting better every week. And last week, you know, they ran the football 42 times. Now, granted, Minnesota's defense, I don't know that there's been a team who's – yeah, there has. Minnesota and Buffalo together – I haven't seen two defenses that were good, you know, go bad as fast as those two have gone this year. Both of those defenses are, you know, major disappointments from what they had been in the past. But Chicago is doing what they need to do. And for Jacksonville, you know, for everything we were joking about with Mitchell Trubisky and being drafted so high, you're the Jacksonville Jaguars right now. The Jets just gave you the biggest Christmas present in the world. They just wrapped up Trevor Lawrence for you. The only thing that stands between you and Trevor Lawrence is yourselves. If you screw up and win a football game. And that's the other reason why the teaser is so much more attractive with teasing Chicago down just to win this game, you know, at 1.5. Now, if they win by one, I will pull out what remaining hair I have left, and I don't have a lot, but it will be pulled out if they win by one, because I'm teasing them down to 1.5. But Chicago is, you know, they need the game. They're driving for the playoffs, so you're going to get a full effort. They have confidence and swagger right now, do the Bears. And the Bears still have a good defense, all right? Jacksonville, they scored 10 and 14 points the last 2 weeks. Against Baltimore on the road, okay, I get that. Baltimore's got a good defense. But you only score 10 points at home against Tennessee. Tennessee's defense is, you know, horrible, okay? That's the nicest way I can say it. You only score 10 points against them. You're not going to score a lot of points against Chicago. Now, granted, there is one player on Jacksonville that wants to win and wants to do well, okay? And that would be Minshew, okay? Because he's fighting for a job. And if it's not here in Jacksonville, if they, you know, draft Trevor Lawrence, he's going to be looking somewhere else to try to land. So he definitely, that's the one motivated Jacksonville Jaguar that you're going to have there. Mm-hmm. I think everybody else has the memo, you know, you don't win. Right. But, yeah, this is a team that can't get out of their own way. Defensively, they've given up 27 or more points in five straight games. Yeah, I'm going to take Chicago. Do I want to lay the whole 7.5 here? Probably not. I don't know that I have that much coming back to trust Trubisky, but in teasers all day long. All day long.
Absolutely. And I'm going to look at the over too for a couple stars. Over 47. The reason that is because Jacksonville's defense is so beat up. I mean, Allen, their best player, has been out and on IR. And they at least have DJ Chark, Laviska Shenault back on at receiver. I think they're going to get some points here at home. And I think the Bears are going to get at least 30. So I like the over 47 as well. The Bears are playing well, but the Bears on defense have their two of their four secondary was out last game, and their nickel corner was out too. So I you know, you're going to see some points scored from Jacksonville, in my opinion. So I think the over's in play for sure. Two stars, premium play. Well, we have two games left, but we only have about 5 minutes left, Marco. The Denver versus Chargers, or the Buffalo versus New England plus 7. Which one do you want to? Which one's better to cover for you?
Well, you know what? I can get both of them in quickly for you because there's not a lot to say on the Charger game. And the Chargers game is just this. As bad as Denver is and as bad as Denver has looked, I do not want to lay points. Repeat after me. I do not want to lay points with an Anthony Lynn-coached football team. I will take the better defense getting points. And I know technically if you look right now after last week's games, things juggled around a little bit. The Chargers technically have a better defense at yards per play, but Denver's defensive numbers got a little bit skewed the last 4 weeks because they've played the Saints, the Chiefs, and the Buffalo Bills, three of the better offenses in football. That's not the Chargers. I'll go ahead and take Denver plus the points. Mild upset, and throw a little stat at you. Last two seasons, the Chargers, after gaining 400 or more total yards in their previous game, 0-9 against the spread the next week. So we will go ahead, take Denver plus the points. And quickly on the Monday night game, Buffalo, they're playing with house money now. They do have something to win, play for. That is home, you know, get the number two seed. They control their own destiny for the number two seed. But this is still the New England Patriots, who do have a great defense. I think they can slow Buffalo down enough. You saw that in the first game. And here's a number with Bill Belichick. We'll find out if it was him or if it was Brady. But since he's been the head coach of the New England Patriots, Bill Belichick has only been a home underdog 16 times. 13-3 against the spread. Throw it on Monday Night Football, home divisional dog, trying to play spoiler as far as seeding goes, because Buffalo's already clinched a division, which that also might classify fat and sassy after clinching. I'll take New England plus the points.
All right, there you go. Two plays. Look at that. Marco's feeling generous today. I love it, man. Power ratings for my Denver game. I have Denver 3 points, -3, and the spread's about 3.5. So I will be taking the Denver Broncos past the 3 at even. I'm going to wait for a -110 there, and it's probably starting to pop up left and right here. I got to look again. My algorithm also has it at 3, but my algorithm doesn't factor in the massive injuries Denver had. I mean, locked in, play a bunch of games. Their defense was extremely injured, which means that the game should be closer than that. So I will definitely be taking them. I only have Buffalo by 3.75 points here on the road at New England. I think New England might have it in to stick it to them one more time. This is their only motivation. This could be, you know, at least something to go out nicely on. So I do agree with you. I only have it as a lean right now because I'm not sure what kind of Buffalo team you're going to get. You might get that crazy out of his mind, Josh Allen, but super strong lean to the Patriots, in my opinion. Any other college games that you want to throw out there? Well, any college games, I should say. We didn't talk about any for bowl season.
Yeah, for the bowl season right now, for me, Nothing yet, because I'm going to be taking everything on a game-by-game basis. And this is one tip I will say for your listeners as far as the bowl games go. And as I'm kind of wanting to watch these first couple and see the motivational edge, this is the biggest. Motivation is huge in the bowls every year, Kiev. This year, it's going to be even more, because you got to question the teams other than the four playoff teams and the teams that are on, you know, the big six bowl games. Who really wants to be here? Some teams will, some teams won't. And I would suggest following beat writers. Twitter is so good these days for gathering information. You follow the beat writers that cover the teams in the bowls. Read what they have to say in their columns. They're going to give you how the practices are going, what the team, you know, focus is and such. And normally, teams that are making their first trip to bowl games, a lot of times can be distracted by everything that's going on around the bowl game. That's not going to be an issue this year. You're not going to have all the, you know, extracurricular activities that go with bowl games this year because of the lockdown situation and, you know, quarantines and such. So I think those teams, you know, won't be distracted. Like we say so many times, you know, you get a team from the Midwest that ends up at a bowl game on a beach. Do we really want to play football? You know, it's 20 degrees back home. No, let's go to the beach and enjoy the sights and sounds. I don't think that's going to be an issue this year.
Yeah, that's true. You got to think about that. There's not as much hanging out to do. So keep that in mind when you are playing these bowl games. Marco, where can our listeners find your great information and plays?
Well, absolutely. Follow me on Twitter, Marco in Vegas. That's the easy way to see everything that I'm talking about. And you might get a lot of pictures of my chicken wings as well. and then head over to wagertalk.com and check out our YouTube channel, Wagertalk TV on YouTube. There is just everything imaginable there. The show, obviously, that I'm with and on every week is Bet On It. It has been a huge success for Wager Talk, and the following we have with that show, it's almost like a cult following. If we're like 20 minutes behind when we usually post it, you know, YouTube slow uploading or whatever, man, people start tweeting at us, where's the show? And, you know, that really makes me feel good that people look forward to that show every week. It airs Wednesday night. We tape it Wednesday afternoon, and it gets up generally by around 8 o'clock Eastern time Wednesday night. And it's a fun show and a lot of information.
You know, and it's a fantastic show, and you have the best guests anywhere, I should say, to bring on. Just some extremely sharp people, some of the best known in Vegas, Marco. And to you listeners out there, if you want to follow Marco in Vegas, he's a foodie. He's gonna make you hungry if you're gonna look at that Twitter timeline. So just remember that. You might have to poke him for a few of those recipes that he comes up with. Well, thanks again, Marco. Have a very Merry Christmas. Enjoy the bowl season. Enjoy the NFL this weekend.
Thanks, Kiev. Always a pleasure doing your show.
And now it is time for
the Sharp Side of the Force.
The Sharp Side of the Force is brought to you by uwager.eu for an 80% sign-up bonus. Please visit uwager. Use the promo code OddsBreakers. Terms, conditions, and location apply. We'll start out with Sharp College from December 23rd to the 29th of bowl games. As of Tuesday afternoon, Sharp Money on Hawaii from plus 13 to plus 11. 53% of the tickets. And 95% of the money on Hawaii. Sharp money on Marshall, plus 4.5 to plus 3.5 versus Buffalo. 50% of the tickets and 85% of the money. Sharp money on UAB, minus 5.5 to minus 7 versus South Carolina. 75% of the tickets on UAB and 97% of the money. Sharp money on Georgia State, minus 4 versus Western Kentucky. 51% of the tickets on Georgia State, 97% of the money. Sharp money on Miami, plus 3 to plus 2.5 versus Oklahoma State, 47% of the tickets and 93% of the money. Sharp money on Colorado, plus 12.5 to plus 11.5 versus Texas. Dual action, 80% of the tickets on Colorado and 99% of the money. Sharp totals, Hawaii versus Houston, under 61.5 to 60. 31% of the tickets and 85% of the money. Sharp totals on Western Kentucky versus Georgia State under 55.5 all the way down to 51. 86% of the tickets and 99% of the money. Dual action there. Sharp money on the Liberty versus Coastal Carolina under 60 to 58. 43% of the tickets on the under and 93% of the money. Sharp NFL week 16 as of Tuesday afternoon. Sharp money on Indianapolis plus 3 all the way to minus 1.5 at the Steelers. 69% of the tickets on Indianapolis, 99% of the money. Sharp money on Philadelphia at Pick'em to minus 2 at Dallas. 74% of the tickets and 89% of the money. Dual action. Sharp money on the Rams plus 2.5 to plus 1 at Seattle. 46% of the tickets on the Rams and 66% of the money. Sharp money on Tennessee plus 4.5 to plus 3.5 at Green Bay. 75% of the tickets and 87% of the money. Dual action there. Sharp money on Chicago minus 3.5 to minus 7.5 at Jacksonville. 83% of the tickets and 97% of the money on Chicago. Dual action. Most people didn't get that 3.5. It went to 7.5 in a split second. It was at 3.5 before their game started on Sunday. Bills minus 4.5 to minus 7.5 at the Patriots. 80% of the tickets on the Bills and 93% of the money. Sharp NFL totals. Vikings versus Saints under 53 to 51. 50% of the tickets on the under, 80% of the money. Sharp man, the Chicago Bears over 46.5 to 47. 44% of the tickets on the over and 75% of the money. That's all we have, my friends. Thank you so much for giving us such a great year at the Odds Breakers. You listeners are the best. If you have any questions about anything or want us to break down a game, please tweet us at the Odds Breakers or contact us via the website. Have a great Christmas and holiday season. Enjoy all of the games and always go get some winners.
Holiday greetings and gay happy meetings when friends come to call. It's the happiest season of all. There'll be parties for hosting, marshmallows for toasting, and caroling out in the snow. There'll be scary ghost stories and tales of the glories of Christmases long, long ago. It's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be much mistletoeing and hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. It's the most wonderful time of the year. Scary ghost stories and tales of the glories of Christmases long, long ago. It's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be much mistletoeing and hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. It's the most wonderful time. Yes, the most wonderful time.